Well, good morning. Happy Easter. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's stand together. We'll sing, shall we? The greatest day in history. Death has beaten you, have rescued me. So happy to see you. I got shook up there. Do you see that? Greatest day in history. Death has beaten you, have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Empty cross, empty grave. Death eternal, you have won the day. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Sing it with me, he's alive. You are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace. Other pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. You ready? He's alive. And oh, happy day, you wash my sin away. Same because God is alive. Amen.
Let the darkness flee. You got no power over me. I have been set free. God is alive. Death, where is your sting? Sin has got no hold on me. God is alive. We've been redeemed. So rise and see. Jesus is alive. The enemy rose.
an empty grave.
The empty grave is singing now, it's shouting now. He is alive, and we are free.
Ready, come on.
The empty grave is singing now, it's shouting now.
He's alive,
he is alive, he is alive, and we are free.
Part, the beginning and the end. Someday, all the earth will recognize what you recognize, that Jesus is not just a guy, he's not just a good guy, he's God, and he's not just Lord, he's our Lord. And someday the entire universe, every person will recognize that he's not just Lord, he's the Lord, Lord over all. You've given your life to him. You've made him the boss of your life. You've made him the king of your life. You've made him Lord of all. Jesus, you lived. You died. You said in 3 days you would rise. You did. You're alive.
You lived. You died, you said in 3 days you would rise. You did, you're alive. You rule, you reign, you said you're coming back again. I know you will, all the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. You take our sins away, oh God. You gave your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of your great love. You lived, you died, you said in 3 days you would rise. You did, you're alive. You rose, you reigned, you said you're coming back again. You know you will. All the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. You take our sins away, oh God. You give your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of your great love.
You lived, you died.
You lived, you died. You said in 3 days you would rise. You did, you're alive. You rose. Coming back again, I know you will. All the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing.
your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. One more time. All the earth will sing your praises. You guys know how much Spanish I know, right? So as I'm singing this next song called El Salvador, if I accidentally say any bad words, just ignore it. This used to bother me to have to tune in between songs, but I saw the Beatles do it, so I fake it. I don't really need to do this. Oy! That wasn't even close. Somehow when you tune your guitar, it's supposed to be a good result. Leroy, just don't hit it so hard. Is this what I need a groupie for?
Yes. I'm not sure.
Or is it roadie? I always get those confused. Oh my goodness.
Tell us a joke.
Lauren, tell him a joke.
Ouch.
That's how we met. That's how we met.
That was Hooters. That was no bar. Oh.
I used to work there. That's how I got through college. Be sure to tip your servers. We'll be here all week. Please be seated.
He came to the dusty town. The people all gathered round. And they saw something in his eyes they had not seen before. They listened as he began to speak like no other man. And they knew that he was the one. When they heard him say, yo soy el camino, yo soy la verdad, yo soy la vida, el Salvador, y nadie viene al Padre sino por mí. Venga y del agua de vida toma. He came to the common man with words we could understand, and they found themselves drawn to him by the love in his eyes. Yet some ought to turn away, while others said not today, but later we'll hear the words that this man has to say. Yo soy el camino, yo soy la verdad, yo soy la vida, el Salvador, y nadie viene al Padre sino por mí. Venga y del agua de vida toma. They led him outside of town. The people all gathered round, and they stood watching as he died, hanging nailed to a tree. but he was laid to rest. But the grave could not hold the vest. Old heroes up and lives again, and the world hears him say, "Yo soy el camino, yo soy la verdad, y yo soy la vida, el salvador, y nadie viene al Padre sino por mí. Venga y del agua de vida toma, venga y del agua de vida toma."
Well, you know the Easter story. Jesus came, that's a Christmas story. Jesus lived, that's another story. Jesus died on the cross. The fact that he rose from the dead, that's the Easter story. And the Bible says, on the first day of the week, Mary and the other ladies went to the grave to finish embalming the Lord, to anoint him with spices. And they wondered, how will we get into the tomb, seeing that we have no man to roll the stone away? And when they got there, they found that the stone had been rolled away, the grave was open, and when they looked inside, what did they find? He's not here. But they found an angel of the Lord who said, "Go tell the disciples that he's risen." They ran back, and they told the disciples, and the disciples, of course, didn't believe it. Kind of didn't, and kind of did. And so John and Paul took off. John and Peter, not Paul. Or Mary.
Or Ringo.
John and Peter ran off for the grave. But John was a younger one. He got there first. But he was a younger one. He's a little scared. Peter, the older one, took him a little longer to get there. But once he got there, he went inside, and he found the grave clothes still there, not unwrapped, unwound, but almost as though Jesus had just come up through them, so that the grave clothes, the linen strips that were wrapped around his body, were just there as an empty shell. They didn't know what to believe. They were afraid that someone stole the body. They were afraid that the Roman soldiers had hidden the Lord. The last thing they thought was that the Lord had been resurrected from the dead. The very thing that Jesus told them would happen? Nah, that's not it. This story is about that. Ouch. That's the way we met. All the windows fastened down. Spent the night in sleeplessness, rose at every sound. Half in fear of the darkness, half in fear of the day. But find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. But just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle, and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. Well, there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me, and she told us where she'd been. She said they moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. We both ran for the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone in the empty grave, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they wrapped him in was just an empty shell. How or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Something strange had happened there, but what I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I've just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high. Then I seen them crucify him, then I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. Until at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. Even if it was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. The light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide, and I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release. And every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace. Would you stand, please? Help us out. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. And I'm going to give it. Heaven gets a roof and a light. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. And I'm going to give it. Heaven.
Let us get so hung up on the struggles of this life that we forget why we're here and who we belong to. God, help us represent you in this world. We love you. We praise you. We pray that you would meet with us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Please be seated. We are glad you're here. Happy Easter. Easter is a great day to celebrate, isn't it? Why not? My goodness. Now, I wouldn't suggest you celebrate like that. You've heard me say a time or two Baptists shouldn't dance. They're both Baptists. See what I mean? Woo! I cut out the good part. Yeah. It gets fancier. Easter's a great day to celebrate. I wouldn't necessarily suggest like that, but we celebrate because Jesus came, Jesus lived, Jesus died, and Jesus rose from the dead. Amen? He did. He really did all the things that the Bible says, if the Bible's true. That's a big old if. I mean, I buy it. I'm a preacher. I'm supposed to believe the Bible. Do you? I mean, for reals. I mean, yeah, we believe that, but I mean, for reals. That means if God says he wants us to do something, we really give it a shot. And we say, well, yeah, but for reals? Yeah, kind of, sort of. I have two big presuppositions. I mean, two biggies. And if these fall, all the rest fails. I believe that there is one God, the God who was first before all the other made-up gods. I mean, there are lots of gods, but there's only one God. One God who's above all other gods. One Lord who is above all other lords. One Jefe, one boss, one that's above all the other. That's a big, you can't prove that. I mean, I could look around and say, well, you could look around at creation and only a fool would say this just happened. In fact, but that's what the Bible says. The fool has said in his heart there is no God. But I can't prove that. I believe that there's a God, and I believe that he's the one true God, and there was a God before all the other gods. That's a big if, but that's my big one. The second one, I believe that the one true God, the God who was first before all the other gods, communicated through this. Not the Quran, not the Book of Mormon, not teachings, traditions of the Catholic Church, not a bunch of Baptist teachings. I believe that a one true God communicated through his one true word. Don't get hung up on which one. If you got one, read that one. Do that one. That's enough. Now, those are two big presuppositions. If those fail, I fall. Does that make sense? But if they're true, guess who's the boss of me? Yeah. Because he is Lord of all, whether I buy it or not, whether I believe it or not. If those are true, then I can buy the rest of it. The rest of this is easy. If I can believe that there is a God and he communicated through this, if I can believe that everything that happened in Genesis 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, if I can believe that God created the heavens and the earth just by speaking it into existence, it's not hard for me to believe that a fish can swallow a dude named Jonah. Oh, see, is that a big deal? If God could create the fish, if God can create the man, he could create a fish big enough to swallow a man and then spit him out 3 days later, like that. Yeah? That's not a big deal. Did any of you watch the Ten Commandments last night on ABC, Charlton Heston? I mean, that's the real Moses right there. Charlton, let my people go, right? That's pretty cool. I loved all that. Who was his wife? What other movie did she play in, do you know? Yvonne DiCarlo? Dun, 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 dun. Was it she Mrs. Munster? Oh, see, Lily Munster was Mrs. Moses. Yeah, that's pretty cool to watch all those guys. I love the Ten Commandments. Most of us get our theology from movies. That's not good. It's just true. Most of us get what we believe about God and the Bible from TV, from movies, from things that we heard. Worse, from sermons. I know where sermons come from. Careful. You want to make sure that any stuff that comes spouting out of my face is coming out of the Bible. Then you can believe it. But most of the stuff, preachers are so full of themselves, not me. But most preachers are so full of themselves and they're so full of something, stuff's going to come out. I mean, you squeeze them, stuff comes out. You poke them like the Pillsbury Doughboy, stuff comes out. It just does. You want to be very careful that whether it's a sermon or a TV show or a movie or something that you've just always believed because mama told me and grandpappy told me that someday, all the stuff we believe about heaven, most of the stuff you all believe about heaven came from movies, came from country western songs. That stuff isn't true if it's not from here. But if this is true, then the Bible says that everything that we've heard and read in secular history about Jesus is true. There really was a guy named Jesus. He really lived a perfect life. He really died on a cross, was really buried, and after 3 days and three nights, he rose from the dead. If that's true, we've got something to celebrate, because that's what Easter is about. I mean, getting together with family and eating stuff and, you know, looking for Easter eggs, yeah, knock yourself out, but you know, all the stuff that people do for Easter, that's fun, that's cool, but that's not the reason to celebrate. The reason to celebrate is the fact that Jesus came and he lived and he died and he rose from the dead. That's Easter. Now, I don't know if anybody ever told you though, you know, I spend a lot of my time telling you that this life is not for you. Your life is for him. I spend a lot of my waking time trying to figure out different ways to tell you the same thing. This life is not your best life now. If you're a believer, if you're a Christian, your best life is not here. If this is your best life, sorry, Joel, if this is your best life, you're going to die and go to hell. If this is your best life now, Jesus said you might as well eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow you're going to die and go to hell. If you're a believer, this ain't all there is to it. I know life is tough. I have a great life. Thank you, God. I have a great life. Met my wife at Hooters. Where'd she say we met? I have a great wife. I have a great life. I love you guys. I love what I do. I've got a couple of bucks in my pocket. Thank you, Lord. I got Pepsis and Coca-Cola in the fridge. I can choose. I can have tacos or hamburgers for lunch. Thank you very much. Yeah. For Thanksgiving, I can have turkey or tacos. It's a good life. Listen, when you're in a position where you've got some control over what bridge you sleep under and what rags you have on your back and what you're eating for lunch, when you have a little bit of control over that, man, you are prosperous. We're a blessed people. And we take for granted that we're blessed people. We must be okay. Not necessarily. Some of the most godly people you read about in the Bible had the most horrible lives. Lives of pressure. Lives of persecution. The world hated them. And Jesus said, if you identify with me, Jesus said, if you choose to identify with me, you will be hated as well. Jesus said, be careful when all men speak well of you. So far, I'm doing pretty good. Yeah. You want to be careful. Who do you want to love you? The world or the wonderful one? This group or God? I mean, I want you to love me. Oh, they love me. They really do. But when push comes to shove, who do we really want to please? Now, having said that, I spend most of my waking time trying to figure out ways to tell you this life is not about you. I don't know if anybody ever told you, but Easter is for you. That's the whole point. If I were God, I would have come up with some other plan. I really would. If I were God, I wouldn't have made you. I mean, I like you, but I wouldn't have made you. I wouldn't have made Adam. I sure wouldn't have made Satan before or after the curse. Would you? No way. That was my man voice. He's my accent coming out. My accent is not Mexican. It's girl when it comes out. My accent is puberty. I wouldn't have done it this way. I would have done it another way. But guess who's not God? If this is true, if there is one true God, and if he communicated through this, you know what he says? Everything that's happening is for his glory. I don't get it. I may not even like it, but that's what it says. Everything is happening for his glory. Everything is happening for his pleasure. Oh, so maybe he's a God that's a megalomaniac. Oh, my big blue head. He is so full of himself. He's just crazy. He's just gone to seed on himself. The Bible says he's a jealous God, but he's jealous for you. He doesn't want anybody messing with you. The Bible says that there are no other gods, and I'll have no other gods in my face. That's one of the commandments. I'll have no other gods before me. He said, don't take your God and shake it up in my face, is what he's saying. It's not because he's got an ego problem. It's not because he's got a personality quirk. He's got more than one personality. That's not it at all. He's the one true God. He communicated through the one true Bible. And he says, all of this is for my glory. And in spite of the fact that everything is happening for his glory, whether I like it or understand it or not, this living thing, this being born in sin thing, this I don't become a sinner because I sin. I sin because I was born a sinner, the Bible says. Easter is for you. Jesus came, Jesus lived, Jesus died, Jesus rose from the dead. You were born, you sinned. Easter is for you. Easter is Jesus dying on the cross, but he didn't stay dead. And we've talked about this over the last few weeks. If he was crucified on Friday, Saturday, rose on Sunday, that's fine. I don't think so. I think he was crucified on Wednesday. Went in the ground. He was in the ground 3 days and three nights. Went in the ground Wednesday evening and rose from the dead Saturday night. And Sunday morning, the ladies got there and he was already risen. But wherever you want to see the crucifixion, the fact is, if this is true, he died. And the big deal is, on the third day, he rose. After the third day, he rose. Easter is for you. He did all that because he loves you. He did all that because he wanted to come for you. He wanted to die for you. He wanted to pay the price for you. Most of us didn't even know we needed an Easter. I mean, we've been doing colored Easter eggs and chocolate bunnies and happy Easter. And do I get to wear white or not till after Memorial Day? Or I always get that wrong. I'm never supposed to wear white pants anymore, I think. That's just because I'm dirty. But, yeah. Most of us, we have our ideas of Easter. Most of what we believe about Easter, we got from TV or movies, tradition. Whatever you did in your family is Easter. Growing up Catholic, we went to church on Easter and Christmas, and it wasn't that we were for our Catholic. I grew up at Ascension Church. It wasn't for it, wasn't against it, never hated God. We went more than that. But, you know, those are the big days. You're supposed to show up on those days. Why? Why those days over the other days? I don't know. It's just the way Grandma and Grandpa did it. That's the way and if they went other times too, well, that's cool. But most of us do what we do because we see what we see. Man, I'm so proud in a way that I can take no credit for it. So proud that I could tell my son and my daughter and my oldest grandson, who spent a lot of his time growing up with us, this Easter, I am so grateful to God that you guys fell in love with the Lord. You've chosen to live for the Lord, and you're leading your families to live for the Lord. Man, is there anything better? I mean, you want your kids to do okay. You want them to be successful. If possible, not serve more than 5 to 10 so that they can live the rest of their lives, you know? But to know that your kids are going to make it through this life and then be able to live in the life to come with the Lord forever. If there's one true God, and if this is his word, he says, this ain't all there is to it. There is a life to come, and it's way longer than this one. This one you get, what, 60, 70, 80? Give it 120 years. Y'all are in pretty good shape. 120 years, and then you die, and you will spend eternity with him or without him, if this is true. If this isn't true, if heaven and hell, all that stuff is just the way we read about it in books and saw in movies and saw on TV and picked up on the street and got from our folks and got from church and, heaven forbid, got from sermons, it doesn't really matter, evidently, because we don't stress over the people in our lives who don't live for the Lord. We don't worry about the people who don't seem to love the Lord. But if this is true, if they don't love the Lord and they're not living for the Lord, he says, they're not going to go to live with the Lord. Most of us didn't even know we needed an Easter, but you so do. Because the Bible says without his living, without his dying, without his being resurrected from the dead, you have no hope at all. If this is true, if this isn't true, eat, drink, and be merry. It really doesn't matter. But if the Bible's true, the Bible says we needed an Easter. We knew about Easter, but most of us didn't know that Easter was about us. The Bible says we sin. Do you know that? Romans 3:23, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We show it in different ways. Sometimes it looks like anger. Sometimes it just looks like frustration. Usually it just looks like us. Think he's having a rough day? Now that's not necessarily sin, but you get the idea. Sin reigns in our bodies, the Bible says. I don't understand that. If I have surgery and, you know, they look for my spleen or they look for a brain or whatever, they're not going to find sin in there. They're not going to find a soul. They're not going to find Jesus in there. But the Bible says that when you give your life to the Lord, that he comes and takes up residence in you. I don't understand it, but that's what it says. The Bible says that before you get saved, sin reigns in us. Sin is the boss of us. Sin is the boss of you. You do what you do because you want to. And sin says, that's cool. Go, boy. Do what you want to do. This is about you. But it's not about you. It's all about him. The indictment against us, if this is true, God's indictment against you is not that you kill people, that you steal from Circle K, or worse, from All Subs. I don't know. We all have a sinometer. God doesn't. The Bible says if you've offended the law in one point, you're guilty of all. That's what the Bible says. Now, I have a sinometer, and I say this all the time. If you're going to take something from me, I'd rather you take my pen than my life. I have a sinometer. God doesn't. God says because you're a sinner, you sin. Busted. That's it. So whatever sin looks like, the point is we're doing what we do because we want to do it. I say this almost every week. You know, the Bible verse that nails it all is, I did it my way. That's not a Bible verse, is it? It's not even singing. Yeah. But the fact that we do it our way, that's the indictment. All we like sheep have gone astray, God said to the prophet Isaiah. We sin, all have sinned, and fall short of the glory of God. You may be in a better position in a social way. Society may rather have you and vote me off the island. But you still come short of the glory of God. You may be gooder than I am. You like that?
Yeah.
Shoot, you might be gooderist. But we all sin and come short of the glory of God. We might both go to Huntington Beach and hang out like I used to hang out in the summers. I spent a couple of weeks with my cousin in Huntington Beach, and he'd come spend a couple of weeks here in Albuquerque, and we enjoyed the summers that way. We'd go to Huntington Beach, and we just lived at the beach, and that was cool. Well, not lived at the beach. I mean, we'd go home and eat, but we spent most of our time at the beach. If we both go to Huntington Beach, and we go to the shore, and we say, let's run and jump to Catalina Island. Okay, you first. No, let's do it together. And so we both run. You're running like that, and I'm running like this, because I hurt. And we run, and we go. I don't know how far Catalina Island is, but it's farther than you can jump from Huntington Beach. You think you'd get closer to Catalina Island than I would in our jumping? Yes. The answer is yes, you would. Would you make it all the way to Catalina Island? And you get somebody younger than you, and they run, and you get some star athlete, and but the fact is, we're all short of making it to Catalina Island. We all sin, and you may be gooder than I am. You might be great, but we sin and we come short of the glory of God. None of us can reach it. Now, I say there's one true God, and I say this is His word, but most of us, I realize that most of us kind of have different ideas about things. And the truth of the matter is most of us, never mind most of them, whoever them are out there, most of us see sin as not so good, but I mean, does it really hurt us? Does our sin or even our stupidity really hurt us all that much? This is mouse trap roulette. I'm gonna play this at home.
Okay.
Now it looks kind of fun.
Down.
Down, right here.
Yep.
Am I good?
Kind of exciting. lucked out. But this is on YouTube. You know how it's gonna turn out, right? Does our sin or our stupidity really hurt us? I mean, really?
This is going to be bad.
Our sin is kind of fun, kind of exciting. Our sin is nobody's business.
I don't like the looks on their face. One, two, three.
Oh! You knew that was going to happen. Does our sin or our stupidity, does it really hurt us? I mean, look around. We're okay. Look around. I mean, we're, well, kind of okay. Yeah, we're kind of okay. Yeah. Really? Is sin as big as, you know, you're a preacher, you're supposed to say something like, sin's awful. Anything fun? Don't, you know me, right? If the Bible doesn't have enough do's and don'ts, I'll give you a big old list that's not even in there. And if I'm not careful, I'll give the impression that living this life is about do this, don't do that, do this, don't do that. That's not it at all. If I'm right on this understanding of the Bible, and if there is one true God and He did communicate His will through the Bible, and if you are accountable to Him, it doesn't matter if you're a good Baptist or a good Catholic. It doesn't matter if you walked up Tomei Hill or made it all the way to Santuario. Why would anybody do that? Knock yourself out. To show that I'm grateful that Jesus did that for my sin. No, you're not. That's like drinking Starbucks. I like to be seen with Starbucks. Who else would pay $20 for burnt stick coffee? Sorry, that's me. People like to be seen with a star. I mean, you may like Starbucks. There's something about going through Starbucks that's different from going through Allsup's. I mean, for 14 cents, you get that much coffee at Allsup's, and $48, you get that much at Starbucks, but you get to call it something different. Café moco latte como tú. tu cosa, I don't know what you call it. Culture tells us what's cool. Culture tells us what to wear. Culture tells us what to believe. And our culture tells us sin is not a big deal. It's kind of fun, it's kind of exciting, and it's kind of none of your business. But God says, if I love you, I'm going to warn you. I'm going to tell you, your sin is separating you from God. That's why you need Easter. Sin separates you from God. Not because you're not a good Baptist or a good Catholic or did the Tome or the Shemayoth. None of that matters. None of that matters. If you really love the Lord and you really appreciate His sacrifice, give your life to Him and live for Him. That's too hard. I'll walk to Shemayo. I hope KOAT comes by and sees me. I'm doing this for Jesus. Look, there's a Google car. Culture tells us what's cool. What are you going to do about that? Our sin, our stupidity, does it really hurt us? Most of us don't think it really does, but Isaiah chapter 53. The Bible says that Jesus was pierced for our sins. What does that mean, pierced? Crucified, nails. He was pierced for our sins. He was crushed for our iniquities, our evil deeds. Is sin a big deal? Not a big deal. It's a little bit fun, a little bit exciting, and it's a little bit none of your business. Except the Bible says it was that sin that nailed Him to the cross. Jesus was pierced for your sins. He was crushed for my evil deeds. Most of us really don't worry that much about sin. We really don't, until it hurts us. And then we might think about sin a little bit. This isn't sin.
Don't turn in his face.
Oh!
It's not sin, but ow.
Oh, oh my God.
Why would you show that stuff? It's not a big deal. And think, oh, things happen. You know what they do? You throw boiling water outside and it turns, ow! And it turns into steam. Well, it doesn't turn into steam all that fast. Oh, man. That's going to cost somebody, huh? Most of us don't worry all that much about sin. We really don't think that much about it until it hurts us. And then we say, oh, that was stupid. But most of us don't stop and say, oh, that was sinful. We just say, oh, that was dumb. I won't do that again until next Friday night. That's Saturday morning, isn't it? Yeah, I love you. It's your life. You can do what you want to do. It's your life, and you can do what you want to do until you give it to Him. And then it's not your life anymore. Everybody doesn't want to do that. I get it. Everybody doesn't want to give their life to the Lord. If you do, you can. If you already have, freaky deaky look like it. Live like it. Lean in His direction. Listen to Him. Love Him. Live for Him. Most of us don't worry all that much about sin until it hurts us. And all of our sin actually hurts other people. Your sin kind of ricochets. This has nothing to do with sin, but it is so hurtfully cool.
Many of these Marlins hitters off balance.
Oh! Ooh,
that one inside. That got Brinson and the home plate umpire, Brian.
Well, check this out. It didn't just hit him. Oh. Here it comes. What's it, about 100 miles an hour? Boom! One leg, two legs, ump, catcher. That's a fourfer right there. Most of us don't think that much about sin. It's not a big deal. My goodness, it's a little bit fun. Sin's a little bit exciting. I don't know that from personal experience. I know that because the Bible says sin is pleasurable for a season. That's the only reason I know. Sin is a little bit fun. Sin is a little bit exciting. And sin is a little bit none of your business. It's my sin. I mean, it's my life. Don't judge me. Don't judge me. The Bible says don't judge. No, it doesn't. It says don't judge unless you want to be judged with that same standard. I don't mind if you judge me with the same standard that I judge you with. Guess what? I'm going to fail too. But if you're willing to help me, man, I am so willing to help you. That's why I'm here. I could be at IHOP this morning too. I could have pretended by going to the sunrise. Never mind. Once a year? Twice a year? Live for Jesus, man. Live for Jesus. You give your life to the Lord, give your life to the Lord. But most of us don't think we need to. You need an Easter because you're a sinner. And your sin, you don't think too much about it until it hurts you. But your sin is not just hurting you, it's ricocheting. And your sin is actually hurting a lot of people. But our sin hurts Jesus the most. Jesus was beaten, and he was flogged. He was beaten with hands. He was beaten with whips. He took the crown of thorns that was rescued from the Notre Dame fire. The real crown of thorns. There's no surviving crown of thorns, or the nail from the cross, or a splinter from the cross. There's nothing like that surviving. Nothing like that in existence. But of all the things they did to the Lord's body, it seems like from what this says, the thing that hurt him the most was not the beating, not the scourging, not the crown of thorns, but as he hung on the cross, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? God, why have you turned your back on me? He knew the answer. God turned his back on the Son whom he loved because Jesus took our sin upon him. It wasn't just the physical pain. It was a spiritual pain of being separated from his heavenly Father. You maybe didn't know that you need an Easter. You need an Easter so you won't be separated from God. If this is your best life now, you might as well just enjoy it because you're going to die here in another 100 years. And when you die, you don't go to be with the Lord. If there's one true God, and if he communicated through this, if he did, it's this hard, this easy. Jesus, ready for the prayer? Here it goes. Three words, big ones. I give up. It almost doesn't matter what the words are. I mean, it does, but it's the attitude of the heart. Jesus, I give up. Why would I do anything stupid like that? I love my life. I have a good life. Remember the Coca-Cola, Pepsi thing? Before I go to bed at night, even when I'm carbing and I'm trying to be good, ooh, forget it. I open the cabinet by the fridge, and I have 50-50s, that's what I call them. They're 50% less salt, just because I like them. It has nothing to do with a health thing. I love those potato chips, Lay's potato chips in the blue bag. And Lay's, those hot ones, what are those called? Not the super hot, just, huh? The potato chips. Flaming hot? Yeah. I can only eat one. Not because, you know how nobody can eat just one. I can eat just one because they're so hot. So I open the cabinet, and especially when I'm trying to be good, I'm not supposed to eat that stuff, right? So open the cabinet. If I leave the cabinet door open and I'm eating the chips out of the bag, it doesn't count because the cabinet door is still open. So I'll eat a couple of those chips, and I eat them with my mouth open, not because I'm a pig. I am, but that's not why. If I close my mouth, it spreads all that fire all over my inside of my mouth and my face. So I eat them like a... And Elmer is already in bed by this time, down the other side of the house. And it doesn't, if I'm super quiet with the cabinet, and I open the bag, Elmer comes walking around the corner. Well, I can't share those with him because they're too hot. Why do I like those? I don't know. Why do I eat one or two? I don't know. Why do I do things that hurt me? And then to drink milk? I know it sounds stupid. That's the way most of us like sin. It's not that we do it because it hurts us. It just doesn't matter. We do what we do because we like it. And it doesn't matter that it hurts us. Jesus chose to live the life that he lived. He wanted to please his heavenly Father. He chose to go to the cross. The Bible says Christ died for the, can you read it? Christ died for the ungodly. Who's that? You. It's me. Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, but God demonstrated his love for us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Our sin hurts Jesus the most. Jesus came, Jesus lived, Jesus died, and Jesus rose from the dead. That's Easter. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. You might not have known that you needed an Easter, but you needed an Easter because God wants to give you mercy. Easter is for you. That's mercy. Say that word with me. Mercy. Mercy is a big deal. Look at me. I sin, I speed. And what do I usually get rewarded with?
That's right.
If I get justice, I get what I deserve. If I get mercy, I don't get what I deserve. Here comes the hammer. Boom! That's justice. Mercy, somebody stops the hammer before it gets to me. Grace, if justice is getting what I deserve, if mercy is not getting what I deserve, grace is getting what I don't deserve. That's his salvation. That's his love. You needed an Easter, the Bible says, because of your sin. Your mercy is God giving us what we couldn't get for ourselves. Easter is for you, and that's mercy. You might have seen this video a time or two. Whoa! That's not supposed to happen, is it? Whoa! So she's throwing the hatchet, and it's supposed to stick. And it, didn't, and it came back at her. It didn't happen three times. I just wanted to see it three times. Yeah. The fact that it missed her, is that because she's awesome? No, she's sopped out. She lucked out. The fact that you haven't been by the judgment of God doesn't mean that you're in good shape. If there's one true God, and if he communicated through the Bible, the fact that you're still kind of sort of okay, I mean, life is tough. You're going through stuff. But the fact that life is kind of sort of okay is all about mercy. It's all about not getting justice. It's not getting what you deserve. That's mercy. And the Easter story is not just not getting what you deserve. It's getting what you don't deserve. It's eternal life. It's salvation. April 17th, Officer Roger Jamu stopped a 22-year-old Keyshawn. The kid is driving with expired plates, pulled him over, talked to him, found out he had an expired license. He talked to the 22-year-old and found out that the kid had taken the risk of driving with an expired license, expired plates. He hadn't been driving for months, but he needed to get to an interview. That's what he told the cop. I've got a job interview at FedEx. And the cop said, let's go. Called his bluff. He said, let's go. I'll give you a ride. And he took him to the FedEx offices, and the kid got the job. Passed the interview, got the job. Everything was on the up and up. And the kid plans to work at FedEx. He's been working at McDonald's for years. He's going to keep the McDonald's job as a second job. And this is what he said of Officer Roger stopping to pick him up. He says, it meant everything to me. It brought my spirits up. It kind of made me happy. I'll be able to take better care of my 2-year-old daughter. Now, he was driving with an expired license, expired plates. What did he deserve? Ticket. Did he get what he deserved? Not justice, but mercy. Yeah. Easter is for you. That's mercy. Sin doesn't have to mess you up. If you buy this proposition that sin is real and that it can mess you up, it doesn't have to mess you up. Sin is something that you have some control over, believe it or not.
That's a rattlesnake.
Don't let it on board.
Oh my gosh, it's
Don't invite sin. Don't entice sin. Don't play with sin. And there it goes. Oh, man. Now, I'm a preacher, so I'm supposed to say this stuff. What are you supposed to do with sin? Run. But sin is kind of fun. Sin is a little bit exciting. And, Tony, sin is none of your beeswax. You need an Easter. If you can do bad and not feel bad, come on, guys, help me out. That's very bad, because that means that it doesn't matter to you. But it should matter to you because it matters to him. Sin doesn't have to mess you up. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, so that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have what? Everlasting life. John 3:16. That God chose to give you eternal life. If there's one true God, and if this is his word, he says he not only chose not to give you justice, not to send you to hell, but to give you eternal life. But do you believe him? That's a big deal, to believe God. Because to believe God, that means you have to buy into that proposition that there's one true God and that he communicated through this word. Because you can't know anything about him except through what he communicated. You can pick it up from sermons. Oh, poor you. You can pick it up from movies and TV. Oh, poor you. You can pick it up from your family, from traditions, from church. Oh, poor you. But if you believe what the Bible says, this says, you're a sinner. Jesus is God. He died for your sins. He rose from the dead. What do you want to do? I give up. Jesus, I want to follow you. I want to live for you. I want to love you. Man, this is Easter. Make it a great Easter. If you haven't given your life to the Lord yet, I'm going to pray. And I'm not going to ask you to stand up. I'm not going to ask you to slip your hand. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. I'm not going to do an altar call. I'm just going to pray. And if you want to talk to God while I'm praying, you go. Not go. Go for it. Yeah. And then when I'm through, we'll all leave. There are goodies back there. Hang around if you'd like. I'm glad you came. Hope you come back. Hope I didn't run you off. But the most important thing is this. If there is only one God, the God who was first, if he did communicate his word through this, then get in and figure it out. Find out what he loves and do it. Find out what he hates. Run from it. Right now, I'm telling you, he hates sin and he wants to give you salvation. Would you pray with me? Would you believe him? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you could pray in your heart. You don't have to pray this out loud. You don't have to pray at all, but if you'd like to, here we go. Lord Jesus, I love you. Thank you for loving me first. I don't understand all this stuff. I don't get all this stuff. I don't even know if I like all this stuff. But right now, I believe that I am a sinner. I'm not perfect. And I believe the standard is not people around me, but you, Lord, above me. I am a sinner. I believe that you are God, Jesus. I don't understand it, but that's what the Bible teaches. So, Jesus, I'm telling you, I know that I am a sinner, and I believe that you are God. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. I'm grateful, Lord, that you rose from the dead. And, Lord, this Easter, I want to nail it down. I want to make it clear. I want to make it very, very sure that I belong to you. So, Jesus, please forgive me. Jesus, please save me. Jesus, please change me. Jesus, please use me. I want to live for you. Thank you, God, that you've given me this opportunity to realize that Easter is not just a great time to celebrate. It's a great time for me to give my life to you. Thank you for loving me, Jesus. I love you back. In your name we pray. And everybody said, amen. God bless you guys. I'm glad you came. Happy Easter. Hey, Elmer.
just as he said. Isn't that good news? That's good news. Love is patient, love is kind, it won't